It's a great pleasure to be here. Just yesterday, I was at the American Heart Association meeting, a totally different kind of stuff. But what I have to tell you is what I'm going to talk about. It's a real emphasis from the medical professional on our gut health. And that's where the role of turmeric comes about. And let me share some of the new things since my last presence over here. So curcumin, or the active, this is the active ingredient in turmeric, or at least that's how much we know. I think the benefits of pure turmeric is probably a lot more than isolated curcumin would be. But that is some part which we still do not know in the scientific field, that what other components are there in turmeric root which could be beneficial. Most of the work that has been done on curcumin alone, which is extracted from turmeric. So don't get bogged down with what is on the slide, but I put all this information here just to emphasize that in recent years, there have been multiple clinical trials where people are actually using supplementation of curcumin in patients related to multiple diseases. And overall, it's all good news. But what I wanted to focus most, like what I've circled here, is look at the amounts. They have used 8 grams of curcumin per day, and there have been no adverse effects, and only beneficial effects with related to, if you look at diseases, obesity, which is a global problem, metabolic syndrome, which is what comes from obesity, leading to diabetes and fatty liver disease, cancer, there are the maximum number of trials in cancer, then going all the way to neurological diseases like depression and arthritis. So it's a whole spectrum of diseases for which curcumin is being tested and evaluated. Another important part, which is main reason why you don't see it as a drug, an FDA-approved drug, rather than it is still sold as a supplement. And the reason for that is that even though they gave something like 8 grams of it, in our circulation, we see nanograms of that. So that is where is the big disconnect as far as FDA is concerned or the medical doctors are concerned. That if you're giving something this much and so little is available in your plasma, is it really the cause of the benefits that we are seeing? So it's like a cause and effect relationship. Since they cannot develop that, that is the reason why it hasn't gone through an FDA approval as a medication for all of these diseases that I showed. And like I was saying, even with 8 grams, there is hardly any adverse effect. The only complaints that the subjects who were enrolled in these studies, what they had was an abdominal fullness and maybe some cases of diarrhea. So this actually, to me, tells me, because I'm going to be starting a clinical study pretty soon too, that this is a very safe supplement, but why can't we bring it to the forefront, to the limelight? And that is where my research is. And based on this, like I mentioned, the major problem is it's very, very poorly absorbed. And so like I mentioned, with 8 grams a day, you have only nanogram levels in the plasma. And so there is a problem in determining what the causal role is and what is its mechanism of action. Even though there have been so many animal studies, we haven't been able to do that. And that is one of the key things needed by FDA to approve anything as a drug. And so another problem is that most of the studies people like to do in isolated cells, and they put a large amount. So they directly say, for example, they take a cancer cell and put curcumin on top of it, and you see the effect. But that is not what is happening if it's not going into plasma. The cell is not, your cancer cell inside your body is not really seeing that curcumin. So that is another major problem. And so a lot of the companies, the people who sell the supplements, curcumin, they have been trying to make curcumin more available. You will see components in it like bioprene and some other additives which they claim increase the concentration. So here is one another important part, like some places you would see a curcumin supplement and they would talk about that it increases the absorption by 2,000-fold. Now think about it, if the absorption is 0.00002 and if it increased 2,000-fold, it's still not a big amount and you can't really say that it is an increase in absorption. You would not never reach the values which people tested. So based on this, we hypothesize in our lab that curcumin may be acting in the intestine. And that's the reason it doesn't really need to get absorbed. It can still have all these beneficial effects because it does something in the intestine itself. And so what is the rationale for thinking like this? So in our intestine, we have millions of bacteria. Actually, we have more number of bacteria in our gastrointestinal tract or intestine all the way to colon. We have more bacteria than we have total number of cells in our body. They have more genes than we have as human beings. So the bacteria or the toxins that they produced are never released into circulation. To give you an example, the amount of endotoxin or LPS that bacteria produce, if that was to be released into your circulation, you'll be dead in 30 seconds. It's that amount of toxin which is in your gut. And just imagine the pressure we are putting on an intestinal wall to keep it all inside the intestine and don't let it come out. So we have very good mechanism to keep a strong, strong barrier and not let this endotoxin or bacterial toxin come into our circulation. And therefore, if this intestinal barrier is breached, these products will be released probably very slowly into our circulation. They cause inflammation, and that is the result for development of diseases like diabetes or heart disease or kidney disease. And now we are seeing more and more information that that could be related to development of cancer, development of arthritis, development of even neurological diseases. So just to give you a very diagrammatic representation as to how this is. So if you imagine this is the lumen of your intestine, that's where your, all your food and everything is coming in. So that has one, the intestinal cells which are right here, they produce one enzyme which is called IAP, and that actually degrades this bacterial toxin into an inactive form. So you can think of is that that's your first layer of intestinal barrier. Then we have these mucin layers. They are carbohydrate rich layers, an outer mucin and inner mucin. The role of these two is not to let the bacteria penetrate and touch our cells in our gut. This is the cell lining. Then the cell lining itself is a very, very tight lining, and they have a lot of protective mechanisms that they use to prevent this bacteria to move further. And then eventually, if the bacteria somehow through these disruptions comes all the way here, these are again some special cells in the intestinal wall which produce antibacterial proteins that can then destroy the bacteria which are trying to get in. So that is what I was saying, that in evolution or whatever, we have come to live with these bacteria. We need them. We need them for a lot of different physiological function, but we want to let them be in the place they are. We don't want in rest of our body. So we have developed this extensive system of this four-layer barrier which is protecting us all the time. So let me share you some bit of data with you. So do not get caught up in all of this, but these are the proteins. Let's go back here. So these cells right here, these are called tight junctions. So they have to be very, very tight that they should not let anything go through them. And so there are several proteins which make them stay very tight and not make it leaky. And so some of those proteins are ZO1, CLDN1, and CLDN7. And what I want you to look at it, these are just human intestinal cells, and you see this nice wall around them. That is what where these different proteins are. So you see this nice wall here for all of these three proteins. But if you take this bacterial endotoxin and put it on these cells, look what happens, this wall dissociates. So you can imagine if those bacterial toxins somehow were to reach your intestinal cell, this is what it is doing to it. And there is another protein. This protein is present inside the cell, so it is almost like you have a dome tent. You have those little wires going through which holds the tent out. So this is a protein called actin, which stretches out like this, keeping the cell completely tight and therefore preventing any gaps in between. So like here, you can see how nicely the lattice of this protein is, but that completely disappears when you have this bacterial toxin. So this is what a bacterial toxin does. But look what happens when you put curcumin in the sample, or you treat the cells with curcumin before. This line is back. This is almost getting back. This is completely, compared to this, it's all restored. Here it was completely gone, and you can see these fibers are coming back again. So this clearly shows what curcumin does at a cell level. We can actually figure out. And we have been working on this, and actually I was very lucky. We just got this paper published just a few months earlier this year. Now another second layer, which I had told you about, that there is this mucin layer. It's a high carbohydrate layer, which is on top of your cells. So this, here is one thing. We have switched to a very refined diet. It's a high fat, high cholesterol containing diet. And that diet has very little carbohydrate in it. This bacteria, for some reason, they cannot digest fat. They need small amount of this complex carbohydrate in our food. So just imagine, by eating a diet which does not have all these carbohydrates in it, you are essentially starving the bacteria. Bacteria doesn't want to die, it wants to live on something. What does it do? It starts eating up the mucin layer, which is rich in carbohydrate in your body. And that's the reason, you can imagine, just because eating a diet which does not have complex carbohydrates, these bacteria now are eating your gut away. And so this is essentially what happens if you take this is from an animal which was fed a regular diet, which has high fiber and everything. You see this blue layer like this? That is the mucin layer. So all of these are the cells in the intestine. So you see this is a pretty continuous layer. You give them what we call as the Western diet, or high fat, high cholesterol containing diet. Look what happened. The bacteria have pretty much eaten up most of this layer. But what is more important is that if we give them Western diet plus curcumin, look at the improvement. This layer is coming back. It was completely gone right here. It's tending to come back here. So here, curcumin, that means not only was it affecting making the cells tight, you go up, it's making that the mucin layer doesn't get disrupted, so the bacteria cannot go in. Another thing which happens is how our intestinal wall protects us is by getting all these different defense cells, like we have, they are called macrophages. Macro is a Greek word, macro, big, phage, eater. So these are big eaters. They're basically there to gobble up all the foreign material that is there. So intestine, because it encounters all this thing that we eat every day without taking much concern what we are putting in our body, that macrophages come into the layer to protect it. But if there are too many of them, that is what causes the inflammation. So the next thing we looked at is what happens when we eat so much of Western diet. If we are irritating something, there'll be more inflammation, there'll be more macrophages coming in. So as you see here, if the animals were just fed a normal diet, you have certain level of macrophages, which is normal, they have to keep a protection. But just imagine, the moment you give them a Western diet, this number just goes up, almost twofold increase. And what does curcumin do? It brings it back right here. So it means even the gut inflammation, it's protecting it from there. So this is kind of my summary. I think last time when I had talked to you, I had shown you some data that what Western diet does is it blocks the activity of this enzyme. So basically you're making more and more this endotoxin which is active. And curcumin actually increases the activity of this enzyme. Western diet, like I showed you just now on the mucin layer, disrupts these two. Western diet also makes this layer very leaky. As a result, we have increase in macrophages, we have increase in inflammation, increase in the permeability because those junctions are not very tight. And what all of this leads to, this endotoxin, which should have been staying only in the lumen, this bacterial endotoxin starts coming into the circulation. And we have this constant small amount of endotoxin in our circulation on a daily basis. And that activates the macrophages in our system. They go into tissues they shouldn't go. They go into the artery wall, they call atherosclerosis or the heart disease. If these macrophages go into your adipose tissue, it causes type 2 diabetes. So this is our current model that we are working on, what I showed you, that if you have Western diet, this permeability changes, this tight junction proteins change, all these proteins, there is more LPS in circulation, which causes heart disease, diabetes, kidney disease. But since curcumin blocks this part, curcumin can prevent all of these three. So like what I showed you in the clinical trials, people are talking about 8 grams of curcumin given to the people, seeing such beneficial effects, but everybody is focused on how much has gone into our plasma. Maybe we don't even need to take it into our plasma. Maybe what we need is, if it stays in the gut, it's going to protect us anyway by different mechanisms. And actually for ulcerative colitis or inflammatory bowel disease, that question doesn't come because it's a disease of the gut. So people use it more frequently for that. But what we are trying to show to the community, the scientific community, that we don't need to take it into our gut. Let it be in the intestine, it'll have all its effects there. And that's where it comes, consumption of whether it is curcumin or fresh turmeric, that we are going to prevent all these diseases. So I thank you for your attention and welcome to answer. Yes.
You know, everything that I've read, you know, the studies you're talking about, everything says you should take black pepper with the curcumin. How does that, did any of those, you know, is that even logical?
Here is the question. Black pepper contains peprazine, and some of these nutritional supplement companies have found that if you give oral curcumin, if you add peprazine to it, its absorption increases. And that's where it comes, what I was telling you. Okay. If somebody claims it's a 100-fold increase in absorption, but 100-fold of what?
Right.
So that is where the question is, that even after increasing, that's the logic behind black pepper, but not to take away from the ancient knowledge that we have. Black pepper by itself has a lot of good effects. So we do not know whether addition, they talk about it because of its absorption. That is where I disagree. But black pepper having its beneficial effects on its own or in combination with turmeric, no doubt about it. They are.
I was curious as to whether you have thought about helping dialysis patients. I don't know. I mean, it just makes me think, okay, we have a growing problem with this dialysis, kidney failure, all that. Has any experiments been done in that regard about dialysis.
Yes, so that is actually my husband who started work on curcumin. He's a nephrology researcher and he works with chronic kidney disease. And it has a tremendous improvement in kidney function. We haven't had much luck in getting approval to test it in humans. I have just managed to get my first funding through VCU, and we'll start our studies starting January. But this is also, again, like what I was telling you, the disconnect between curcumin absorption and its benefit, it becomes a problem for the regulatory industry. Anybody, like whether they approve protocols to enroll patients, we cannot use, curcumin is sold as a supplement, right? But if we want to use it in a study, if we want to do a clinical study, and if we want to measure any clinical parameter, FDA doesn't allow that. Because FDA, you have to get what is called as investigational new drug. So I'm working towards it. So right now we got permission to only check whether the intestinal permeability is affected. But I'm working towards it. We'll probably get an IND from FDA and then be able to test it in other patients. Yes.
Would you, in your experience, would you expect that there's any difference between the health benefits of fresh turmeric versus dried supplements?
We are, like that's what you know about, we have been trying with Dr. Carly Raffi at Virginia Tech. We are putting a grant together with USDA trying to do exactly that, take fresh turmeric, supplement it every day in a kind of a smoothie. She has developed a recipe for a smoothie, and that's where we are going to monitor. And my guess would be that probably fresh turmeric is even better than curcumin supplement. But we have to do many more clinical studies to be able to do that.
Can you comment on the purity of supplement of the supplements, over-the-counter supplements, turmeric supplements?
So I don't have any experience with turmeric supplements. The only supplements we use for the sake of clarity for scientific research, we have only used curcumin. So curcumin is just one chemical compound from turmeric. You had a question right there, Vina.
How big of a piece of turmeric would have 8 grams of curcumin?
8 grams is a limit they are reaching there, but a small slice, maybe half a centimeter thick slice of a turmeric, okay, consumption daily should be pretty good. That is trying to test the reason for going such high limits was exactly that, because you cannot measure it in your blood circulation. That's why people give high.
You don't have to eat like a whole bag of turmeric.
Actually, they have done, all those clinical studies, they have done what is called as dose escalation. They start with very low amount and go to higher amount, and they see beneficial effects right from a small amount.
Okay. I was under the impression that the Western diet had quite a bit of carbohydrate.
Simple carb. It's simple carbohydrate. Western diet is very rich in sucrose. And so the bacteria, pretty much, we don't have the ability to digest a lot of fiber. When I'm saying complex carbohydrate, it's like fiber. And so we don't digest it, that stays in our gut, and the bacteria eat that. That's a major source for them. They wouldn't.
Isn't there quite a bit of research that sugar also is causing inflammatory
process? Yeah, sugar, that is one thing which I have, you hear so much about high fructose corn syrup as a substitute for sugar. And yes, technically both are sugars, but the difference between sucrose, which is our normal natural cane sugar, versus high fructose corn syrup, which is used as a sweetener in most of the drinks and cookies. Nowadays, you cannot find a product which doesn't have high fructose corn syrup. The difference between them is the biochemical pathways that fructose takes versus what happens to sucrose, they are very, very different. And that's the reason high fructose corn syrup is problematic. It starts a whole different pathway, which is going in the wrong direction in the body. Even though sucrose is nothing but a fructose and glucose molecules put together, but we never get it in large enough amount like you get in high fructose syrup. Yes?
I was just wondering, in terms of the ginger and turmeric, there are other different types of turmeric. Are you looking at other compounds as well that might, outside of curcumin, might be beneficial as well?
We are not at that stage yet. I want to first be able to establish a cause and effect relationship with curcumin before going. So like right up front, I had said that we should not just concentrate on one thing, because these things are coming from ancient times, ancient civilizations like India and China. China is so big on ginger, India is so big on turmeric. And I will tell you one example growing up for me, that anytime, so what happens is if you have a sudden injury, the organ where the blood circulation is immediately affected is actually our intestine. And intestine not getting enough blood supply will have a leaky. So in India, it's a concept that if you have a serious injury, like say you get hurt and you have a big cut or whatever, you know what they do? They take a glass of milk, put a spoonful of turmeric in it, mix it up, and that's the first thing given to an individual to drink. I grew up with that as a child, never understanding, had many scrapes while riding my bike as a kid, and that's what my mother used to give. And only now I'm realizing that giving that turmeric, a big, like a heap full of, teaspoonful of turmeric in a small glass of warm milk, imagine you are just putting it there, making sure your intestine doesn't get leaky, because you have just hurt yourself, you have other injuries coming in, other source of infection coming in, you don't want anything else going on. So there is a lot of wisdom in pure turmeric. I hope we can go to that stage that identify individual components.
Thank you.